Well, if you're thinking about the facts, like the mystery around the existence of the Black Taj, or the fact that the displayed tombs of Shah Jahan and Mumtaz aren't actual tombs but cenotaphs, don't worry, because those facts are quite known to the world. So we will be talking about some actual least known facts about the wonderful Taj Mahal. So without wasting any more time, let's just get on with the video. In the words of Shah Jahan's early historian, Muhammad Amin Qazvini, he wrote about the Taj Mahal in the 1630s and he says, "In a dome of high foundation and a building of great magnificence was founded, a similar and equal to it the eye of the age has not seen under these nine walls of the enamel blue sky. Anything resembling it the ear of time has not heard in any of the past ages. It will be the masterpiece of the days to come, and that which adds to the astonishment of humanity at large." Without wasting any more time, let's just move ahead to the actual points. So number one, Shastric symbolism in the Taj Mahal. The only building in the whole complex made entirely with white marble is the mausoleum. All the subsidiary structures of the Taj complex are built with red sandstone. Special features such as domes may be clad in white marble. The hierarchic use of white marble and red sandstone is typical of Mughal imperial architecture. It represents the clearest link to pre-Islamic Indian Shastric concepts and expresses social stratification. The Vishnu Dharmotra, an authoritative compilation composed in Kashmir in about the 8th century, recommended white colored stone for Brahmin buildings and red for those of the Kshatriyas, the warrior caste. By using white and red in their buildings, the Mughals represented themselves in the terms of the two highest levels of Indian social system. Architecturally speaking, they were the new Brahmins and the new Kshatriyas of the age. The Mughal emperors were concerned to define themselves as rulers in Indian as well as Muslim terms. The historian Abdul Al-Qadir Badawi, who was an Orthodox Muslim, wrote a history of Akbar on his own account and went on to criticize the emperor for letting himself be addressed as an incarnation like Rama and Krishna. Number 2. Unique cenotaphs of Shah Jahan. On both cenotaphs of Shah Jahan, which were placed next to those of Mumtaz after his death in 1666, the decoration with heavenly flowers was given preference over inscriptions. Inscriptions had decorated the sarcophagus-like element of both cenotaphs of Mumtaz, the one in the lower and the other in the upper chamber, and full flowering plants appear only on the platform of her upper cenotaph. But both Shah Jahan's cenotaphs are covered all over with flowers. The only epigraphy appears in the form of a brief historical epitaph at the south end of each cenotaph. The exclusively floral decoration of the emperor's cenotaphs make a more specific statement. The court poets and writers tell us that Shah Jahan was the spring of the flower garden of justice and generosity, the rejuvenator under whose rule Hindustan has become the rose garden of the earth, and his reign has become the spring season of the age in which the days and nights are young. Number 3. The minarets. At the corners of the base stand the minarets. These are four large towers, each more than 40 meters tall. The towers are designed as walking minarets, a traditional element of mosque, a place for a muezzin to call the Islamic faithful to prayer. Each of the minarets was constructed slightly out of plumb to the outside of the base, so that in the event of collapse or earthquake, the structure would fall away from the tomb. Each minaret is effectively divided into three equal parts by two balconies that ring the tower. At the top of the tower is the final balcony surmounted by a chhatri that echoes the design of those on the tomb. The minaret chhatris share the same finishing touches, a lotus design topped by a gilded finial. Minarets did not become a common feature of Mughal architecture until the 17th century, particularly under the patronage of Shah Jahan. A few precedents exist in the 20 years before the construction of the Taj in the tomb of Akbar and the tomb of Jahangir. Their increasing use was influenced by developments elsewhere in the Islamic world, particularly in Ottoman and Timurid architecture, and is seen as suggestive of an increasing religious orthodoxy of the Mughal dynasty. Number 4. Historical ownership of the Taj Mahal site. The site chosen for the Taj Mahal lies on the right bank of the Yamuna, on the southern edge of the city. The property, one of the riverfront residents of Agra, had belonged to Raja Man Singh of Amber and had come down to the Raja's grandson, Jai Singh. Shah Jahan was drawn to it because, his historian Kazvini says, from the point of view of loftiness and pleasantness, it appeared to be worthy of the burial site for one who dwells in paradise. Jai Singh was prepared to present the property to Shah Jahan, but the emperor, anxious to proceed without a shade of doubt in the sensitive matter of his queen's last resting place, insisted on giving him in exchange 4 other mansions at Agra. Number 5. Sound as an expression of eternity. In the interior of the mausoleum, even sound had to invoke eternity. The dome of the tomb chamber holds tone for almost half a minute, as the musician Paul Horn demonstrated in a night session with his flute on 25th April 1968. He was inspired by the tomb attendant who habitually calls out to demonstrate the remarkable acoustics. He mentioned that each tone hung suspended in space for about 20 seconds and the acoustics are very much perfect. Also, the individual tone didn't spread as in other great halls but remained pure and round to the very end. The acoustics of the Taj Mahal were first described in 1836 by Captain Sleeman, an early British observer of the Taj Mahal. Bonus fact: inscriptions as a decorative substitute. As we all know, there is a religious prohibition against figural representation in Islam, so great importance is given to inscriptions regarding decoration of religious buildings. The Taj Mahal displays the largest inscriptional program in the Islamic world. It has 25 Quranic inscriptions, of which 14 are complete surahs. The inscriptions appear on 3 of the 4 major buildings, those are the Great Gate, the Mausoleum and the Mosque. Thus, we can all agree to the words of Shah Jahan's main historian, Abdul Al-Hamid Lahori, who says, "It was to testify to the power and glory of Shah Jahan and the Mughal rule. They laid the plan for a magnificent building and a dome of high foundation, which for its loftiness will until the day of resurrection remain a memorial to the sky-reaching ambition of His Majesty, the Sahib-e-Kirani Thani, and its strength will represent the firmness of the intentions of its builder." That was all for today. If you liked the video and you think you have learned a thing or two, make sure to hit the subscription button and like and share the video.